Hello students, today we shall discuss Constituent Assembly and Establishment of Republic. Making Indian Constitution was a big task for the Indians, who were referred to as illiterate and uncivilized. British assumed Indians as incapable of running the country and that they don't have skills to run the administration, but the journey of Indian Republic proved them wrong. India has emerged as the world's largest and successful democracy. Constituent Assembly was established when British agreed to free India. It was a long struggle of India for independence. British made all arrangements which could help in smooth transfer of power. A Constituent Assembly is a body of representatives which was constituted for drafting a constitution. We have to note that drafting the constitution is the only function of a Constituent Assembly. Constituent Assembly was dissolved when the Constitution was ready to be adopted. Further, the members of the Constituent Assembly became representatives, elected or unelected. That's why many a time Constituent Assembly is referred as representative of the people. Idea of Constituent Assembly. The idea of Constituent Assembly of India was first put forward by M. N. Roy in 1934. In 1935, it became the official demand of Indian National Congress. It was accepted in August 1940 in the August offer, however, constituted under Cabinet Mission Plan 1946. It was first elected for undivided India, but after partition, some of its members ceased to exist, as a separate Constituent Assembly was created for Pakistan. Elections of members of Constituent Assembly. Members of Constituent Assembly were indirectly elected. During British era, India had provincial assemblies like the current legislative assemblies of states. The members of the Constituent Assembly were indirectly elected by the members of the provincial assemblies by method of single transferable vote system of proportional representations. Number of members of Constituent Assembly. Initially, its total membership was kept at 389. After partition, the Constituent Assembly of India had 299 representatives. These included 229 members from provinces and 70 from princely states. There were total of 9 women members also. The membership plan was roughly as per suggestions of the Cabinet Mission Plan. The basis of division of seats was population roughly in 1:10 ratio. First meeting of Constituent Assembly. The first meeting of the Constituent Assembly of India took place in Constitution Hall, New Delhi on 9th December 1946. Dr. Sachidananda Sinha was the first president of the Constituent Assembly. In the first meeting, the Assembly adopted an objective resolution, which later became the preamble of the Constitution. It appointed various committees. The reports of the committees formed the basis on which the first draft of the Constitution was prepared. It reassembled on 14 August 1947 as Constituent Assembly for Independent India. After partition, Dr. Rajendra Prasad became the President of the Constituent Assembly of Independent India. Professor Harendra Kumar Mukherjee was Vice President of the Constituent Assembly. While Dr. Rajendra Prasad later became the President of India, Professor H.C. Mukherjee became first Governor of West Bengal. Objectives Resolution. The historic Objectives Resolution was moved by Jawaharlal Nehru on 13 December 1946. It defined the aims of the Assembly and enshrined the aspirations and values behind the constitution making. On the basis of the Objectives Resolution, India's constitution gave institutional expression to the fundamental commitments: equality, liberty, democracy, sovereignty, and a cosmopolitan identity. The preamble of the Constitution of India is derived from Objectives Resolution. Different committees of the Constituent Assembly. A number of different committees were created by the Constituent Assembly to perform different tasks related to framing of constitution. Most important amongst them was drafting committee headed by Dr. B. R. Ambedkar, which had to draft the constitution. Chairman of other important committees were Rajendra Prasad was chairman of committee on the rules of procedure committee, steering committee, finance and staff committee and ad hoc committee on the national flag. Jawaharlal Nehru was chairman of Union Constitutional Committee, Union Powers Committee and States Committee. This committee was there for negotiating with states. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel was chairman of Provincial Constitution Committee and Advisory Committee on Fundamental Rights, Minorities and Tribal and Excluded Areas. Other members of Drafting Committee. The Drafting Committee of the Constituent Assembly was made of total 7 members, including Chairman Dr. B. R. Ambedkar. The 6 other members were N. Gopalaswamy Iyengar, Alladi Krishnaswamy Iyer, Dr. K. M. Munshi, Sayyid Muhammad Sadullah, N. Madhava Rao, T. T. Krishnamachari. Time, resources were used to draft India's constitution. The Constituent Assembly sat for a total 11 sessions. The first session was held in December 1946. The draft constitution was published in January 1948 and people of India were given 8 months to input their feedback on this. The 11th session was held between 14 and 26 November 1949. The Constitution of India was adopted on 26 November 1949 and the members appended their signature to it on 24 January 1950. Constitution of India came into force on 26 January 1950. On that day, the Constituent Assembly ceased to exist, transforming itself into the Provisional Parliament of India until a new parliament was constituted in 1952 via general elections. The Constituent Assembly took 2 years, 11 months and 18 days to frame the constitution. It spent rupees 64 lakhs in the preparation. The final outcome of the almost 3 years long process was the constitution document with 22 parts, 395 articles and 8 schedules. Provisions of constitution that came into immediate effect on 26 November 1949. Though the constitution came into force on 26 January 1950, some provisions relating to citizenship, elections, provisional parliament, temporary and transitional provisions were given immediate effect on 26 November 1949. The articles which came into force on 26 November 1949 included articles 5, 6, 8, 9, 60, 324, 366, 372, 388, 391, 392 and 393. Out of them, citizenship was the most important and had to immediately come into force to constitutionally handle the refugee crisis due to the partition of India. Sources of Indian Constitution. It was necessary to study various constitutions prevailing around the world. Therefore, founding fathers went through such constitutions and included important provisions in the Indian constitution. I would like to dictate certain provisions taken from other constitutions. Ideal of justice in social, education, economic and political sphere are taken from Russian Revolution of 1917. Ideal of liberty, equality and fraternity are taken from French Revolution of 1889. Federal scheme and office of governor is taken from Government of India Act 1935. Parliamentary form of government is taken from British Constitution. Fundamental rights and independent judiciary is taken from the Constitution of United States. Directive principles of state policy is taken from Ireland. Federation with strong center is taken from Canada. fundamental duties from USSR. Procedures established by law is taken from Japan. Suspension of fundamental rights during emergency taken from Weimar Constitution of Germany. Features of Indian Constitution. India has a parliamentary democracy. There is a Council of Ministers headed by the Prime Minister who enjoys the real powers and is also responsible to the Parliament, which is elected by the people by universal adult franchise. The Indian Constitution provides for fundamental rights which are justifiable. There is a mention of fundamental duties which have been added to the Constitution later. India just has single citizenship. The directive principles of state policy give a concrete shape to the welfare state. A written constitution. A written constitution is framed at a given time and comes into force on a fixed date as a document. Our constitution was framed in 2 years, 11 months and 18 days. It was adopted on 26 November 1949 and enforced on January 26, 1950. Rigid and flexible, the Indian constitution is a unique example of combination of rigidity and flexibility. A constitution is called rigid or flexible on the basis of its amending procedure. In a rigid constitution, amendment of the constitution is not easy, like the constitutions of USA, Switzerland and Australia are rigid constitutions. Whereas British constitution is considered flexible because its amendment procedure is easy and simple. The constitution of India has 3 categories of amendments, ranging from simple to most difficult procedure depending on the nature of the amendment. Federal polity. India has a federal structure. In a federation, there are 2 distinct levels of governments. There is one government for the whole country, which is called the union or central government, and there is a government for each unit or state. The USA is a federation, whereas the Britain has a unitary form of government, where there is only one government for the whole country and the power is centralized. The Constitution of India does not use the term federal state, but calls India a union of states. There is a proper distribution of powers between the union or central government and the state governments in the form of union list, state list, and the concurrent list. Quasi-federal. It means a federal setup where, despite having 2 clear sets of government, central and the states, more powers are given to the central government. Supremacy of the judiciary is an essential feature of a federation, so that the constitution could be interpreted impartially. Parliamentary democracy. India has a parliamentary form of democracy. This has been adopted from the British system. In a parliamentary democracy, there is a close relationship between the legislature and the executive. The cabinet is selected from amongst the members of legislature. The cabinet is responsible to the latter. In this form of democracy, the head of the state is nominal. So in India, the president is the head of the state. Constitutionally, the president has numerous powers, but in practice, the Council of Ministers headed by the Prime Minister exercises these powers. The president has to act on the advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers. Fundamental rights and fundamental duties. The Constitution of India guarantees fundamental rights. The Constitution provides for 6 fundamental rights which are justifiable and hence are protected by the judiciary. Fundamental duties were added to our Constitution by the 42nd Amendment. It lays down a list of 10 fundamental duties for all citizens of India. While the rights are given as guarantees to the people, the duties are obligations which every citizen is expected to perform. Directive principles of state policy. These have been adopted from the Irish Constitution, included in our Constitution to ensure social and economic justice to our people. Directive principles aim at establishing a welfare state in India where there will be no concentration of wealth in the hands of a few. Single integrated judicial system. India has a single integrated judicial system. The Supreme Court is the apex court of the judicial system. Below it are the high courts, which control and supervise the lower courts. The Indian judiciary is like a pyramid, with lower courts at the base, high courts in the middle, and the Supreme Court at the top. Independence of judiciary. Indian judiciary is independent and impartial. It is free from the influence of the executives as well as the legislature. Its judges are appointed on the basis of their qualifications and cannot be removed easily. Neither can their term of office be altered to their disadvantage. Single citizenship. Usually, in a federal state, the citizens enjoy double citizenship like in the USA. But in India, there is only single citizenship, which means that every Indian is a citizen of India, irrespective of the place of his or her residence or place of birth. He or she is not a citizen of the constituent state like Rajasthan, Uttarachal or Chhattisgarh to which he or she may belong. All citizens of India can secure employment anywhere in the country and enjoy all the rights equally in all parts of the nation. Universal adult franchise. Indian democracy functions on the basis of one person, one vote. The Indian Constitution establishes political equality in India through the method of universal adult franchise. Every citizen of India who is 18 years of age or above is entitled to vote in the elections, irrespective of caste, sex, race, religion, or status. Emergency provisions. The Constitution makers expected that there could be situations when the government could not be run in usual manner due to difficult circumstances. To cope with such situations, the Constitution elaborated on emergency provisions. There are three types of emergency. Emergency caused by war, external aggression, or armed rebellion. Emergency arising out of the failure of constitutional machinery in states. And financial emergency. Conclusion. Efforts taken during 3 years resulted into the biggest constitution of the world. Constituent Assembly members experienced conflicts on various issues during Constituent Assembly debates, but still, decisions were taken by unanimity. After the completion of Constitution, India started functioning as an independent republic. Republic is a form of government where citizens have the power to choose representatives to represent them. Head of the state is directly or indirectly elected by the citizens. So here the citizens are empowered by the formation of the constitution. Thank you.